Wendy Nichols, and I'm going to chair this afternoon's deputy leadership hustings. I think you agree we had a pretty good session this morning, and hopefully we'll be able to do the same this afternoon. Welcome to our four candidates. I will explain why we don't have Tom with us when I get to that point in a moment. We are going to follow the same format as we did this morning, and we will be having 4 minutes speeches from each of the candidates, and then we will take the opportunity to ask as many questions as we can, and if we can condense the questions possibly, and even condense the answers, we might be able to get in from all of the 11 regions that are represented here today. We then again will give 2 minutes at the end of that for the candidates to explain why they would want both yourselves and UNISON to support them to become the deputy leader of the party. So firstly, I'm doing this in alphabetical order. So Ben Bradshaw, who has been the Member of Parliament for Exeter since 1997, in the Labour government, Ben was a health minister and the Secretary of State for Culture, Media and Sport. So you're very welcome this afternoon, Ben. Stella Creasy has been a Member of Parliament for the London constituency of Walthamstow since 2010. Stella is particularly well known for her campaigning work on payday loans. And Angela Eagle has been the Member of Parliament for Wallasey since 1992. She served in the government in the Treasury and Work and Pensions. Since October 2011, Angela has been Shadow Leader of the House of Commons. Caroline Flint has been the Member of Parliament for Don Valley since 1997, and she served in the government as the Minister for Public Health, Employment, Housing, and as the Minister for Europe. In 2011, Caroline became Shadow Secretary of State for Energy and Climate Change. And our other candidate in the election is Tom Watson. Tom's had to stay in his constituency, and I'm sure you'll understand why. The majority of the people that were killed in Tunisia are from that area, and there is a big service today at 12 o'clock. So I'm sure we all understand why Tom can't be with us today. So, last-minute change, Dave Anderson will read out Tom's statement to you, but we won't have Dave up on the stage, and Dave won't take part in the question and answer session. So that's how we're proposing to run that today. So we have drawn lots, and the first candidate to speak to you is Stella. So Stella, if you want to go to the rostrum.
Good afternoon, everyone. May I start by extending my condolences to the three members of UNISON who were lost in Tunisia as well. Only one phrase came to mind on May the 8th. Don't mourn, organise. It is a fundamental human right to be able to organise, and it is the shared foundation of our ability as a Labour movement to change the world. And despite what Francis Maude or Matt Hancock might like to think, and your union shows it most of all with 170,000 new members, organised Labour is the future of this country, not its past. Because organising by the trade unions has given us the weekend. It gave us maternity and paternity pay. You have helped not just to protect jobs, but to create them. In doing so, unions have saved British businesses time and money, and the work we've done in the public sector has saved British people's lives. But we know these principles are under attack as never before. This government are trying to do what no democracy would ever countenance any other country and turn an abstention into opposition. And we know that our trade union movement is facing challenges, that many people in our private sector are not part of a trade union, that within the next few years, more people will be self-employed than in the public sector, and that if you don't join a union early on in your career, you're less and less likely to join at all. That means there are millions of people in this global economy in our country at risk of exploitation. Because the future of progressive politics relies on renewing that power of collective action to ensure fairness and prosperity for all of us, and to do it as part of the biggest political organisation in the UK. So if we are to do that, and to use these leadership and deputy leadership hustings to have that debate, it can't be just about us on this panel. It has to be about everyone in this room and everyone who shares our values, and how we can support you in smashing that myth that trade unions are a destructive force and restoring Labour as the champions of social justice in Britain. Because I know many people here feel as frustrated as I do that we haven't had a partnership of equals, that for too often the relationship between Labour and the trade unions has been defined either as a source of a cash point or conflict. Neither does any justice to our shared ambitions. It's vital that we change that and we have a relationship rooted in a mutual respect for the contribution that we all make, and not just the words but the deeds to do it too. And that we do that with the British public. That we draw on the talents and the expertise of everyone who shares our values, but right now is questioning whether they want to work with us. We know that many trade union members voted UKIP or Tory. We know that we've lost support, particularly amongst black and ethnic minority communities in Britain. Too many people see Labour as a machine that only turns up at election time. Now, that's not a fair reflection of the hard work of many, but it is right in this process. We ask how best we work with each other and we work with the public. And we don't have to wait until 2020 to start that. And we have plenty of examples in this room and the way in which we've worked together to show what could be done. I was proud to work with UNISON, with the credit unions, with the legal loan sharking campaign. I was proud to work with you in the No More Page 3 campaign. Cause by cause, community by community, we show the difference that Labour values make. That we are not just an opposition, we are an alternative. And in order to do that, we have to be a team. Because never forget, it's the Labour movement that's putting Wonga out of business. And now we have to do that across this country with the Labour movement. Not just new faces at the top, but new faces supporting the party, using new techniques and new technologies to be not just 250,000 leaders in our communities, but the hundreds of thousands of leaders in our trade union movement and those millions of people who share our values. You can't do that from the back rooms in Westminster. You have to want to be out on the front line. That's the kind of deputy leader I want to be. And with your help, we can win again in 2020. Thank you.
Supporter of the trade union movement, it's a pleasure to be here at UNISON Labour Hustings today. All of you do an invaluable job looking after the interests of your members at work and fighting for better public services and a fairer, more equal society. Empowering working people, solidarity, fighting against injustice, these are the values of the trade union movement, and they're also the values which you bring with you into the work you do in the Labour Party. You're a force for good, and the work you do makes our country a better and more civilised place. My own politics were formed by my parents' experiences growing up working class in Sheffield before there'd ever been a majority Labour government. They taught me that life was hard and opportunities for those of modest means were virtually non-existent. What chances I did have came my way because of the achievements of previous Labour governments who battled to open up access to opportunity for all. They fought the five giants of squalor, ignorance, want, idleness, and disease by setting up the NHS, clearing the slums, extending education to all, and creating our social security system. They left our country a better and fairer place, and our generation of Labour politicians has to strive to do the same thing. Before I beat Linda Chalker to become the first ever Labour MP for Wallasey, many of you will know that I worked for 7 years as a cosy official, where I used to write the nurses' pay claims, and I helped the union to win the first ballot it had to undertake to retain its political fund. But I will always be grateful to this union for letting Bill Berry be my agent when I first stood for Labour in Wallasey. Every time I walk into the House of Commons chamber, I know I couldn't have done it without him. We all know, after the heartbreaking election defeat that we've just suffered, that the wider Labour movement is under attack as never before. We have a majority Conservative government, hell-bent on ripping up the gains in social justice which we've fought for in the last 100 years. The NHS is at risk. Poverty is set to soar. And the Tories still think you're the enemy within. They're not content with the devastating effect their introduction of tribunal fees had on workplace justice. They intend to make it harder for you to organise by ending check-off arrangements, clamping down on facility time, putting even further restrictions on your right to strike and take industrial action. And they want to silence your political voice too by using the law to deprive Labour of funding whilst leaving the influence of their millionaire mates in the hedge funds who bankroll the Tory party completely untouched. We can only resist this if we work together. And our road back to government will be hard and challenging. And that's before Tory gerrymandering of the parliamentary boundaries. We were wiped out by the Nationalists in Scotland, even though I doubled my majority in Wallasey. We know that the road back is hard. We were menaced by UKIP in parts of England. We made a tiny net gain against the Tories, and we now need a swing of over 9% to win in 2020. We had a good manifesto, but it didn't seem to relate to the campaign we fought. We didn't communicate in a language that people understand. So to win in 2020, we need a step change in our politics. That's why I want to be your deputy leader, to help bring that about. I have the experience and values, the commitment to help us win in 2020. I've served as chair of the PLP, vice chair. I spent 8 years as a minister in four different departments and 13 years as a member of the NEC. I love the Labour Party. I see the Labour Party and the trade union movement as two sides of the same coin, and I want us to face and overcome this challenge together. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, conference. Dave Anderson, Leighton Conservative Party. Tom Watson's mouthpiece. These are Tom's words, not mine. I'm very sorry I can't be with you today. My borough lost 3 in the attack on Tunisia. I have to be with their loved ones at civic ceremony today. So thank you for allowing that great human being, Dave. No, I didn't say that. Thank you for allowing Dave Anderson to read out my speech. I visited 109 constituencies during the general election. And wherever I went, there were UNISON activists working hard. UNISON labelling activists did everything they could to send Ed to number 10. But we did lose. And let's be clear about what's happening now. Organised Labour is under systematic attack. In the last Parliament, the Tories removed industrial justice for workers by hiking up tribunal fees. And the result, an 83% reduction in equal pay claims and a 91% drop in sex discrimination claims. Staggering figures. But make no mistake, the Tories' attacks on working people are going to intensify, and so their attacks on organised labour will go further. They want to take away your human rights with new laws on industrial balloting, using standards that we as MPs would never ever accept or apply to ourselves. The government got less than 37% of the vote, but it's one law for the rulers and one for the ruled, as far as Cameron's concerned. No justice, no voice, no rights. That's Cameron's vision of a workers' Britain. And these are not nuanced reforms. In fact, it's not reform at all. There are no problems that need solving here. It's just a powerfully marshalled attack on the collective voice of workers across Britain. And the political response must be clear and unequivocal. Labour must say no. No country in the world has the restrictions the Tories want to put on the right to strike. So the answer is no, no, no. In 33 years of Labour membership, one of my proudest moments was addressing the Durham Miners' Gala. It taught me it's not enough to say you believe in social justice. You have to fight for it. Every day, all the time. And I'm proud to say I've played my part in some important battles. From the Shrewsbury pickets who were framed by the state, to the families who were victimised and violated by the tabloid phone hackers, to the loved ones of Daniel Morgan, whose murder is unsolved because of police corruption. I've been part of the campaign that led two judge-led inquiries into media ethics and child abuse cover-ups. Those campaigns put paedophiles and the Tory Prime Minister's press secretary, where they belong, in jail. My history in trade unions goes back so long that I can even remember seeing Shaken Stevens, the last ever Newbie conference. Anybody there? Back then, history was made with the creation of the first great super union. And since those days, I've supported Labour members like Dave, in brackets, that's you, and Andrew Rayner get into Parliament. I ran a national campaign with UNISON members in the police to get proper anti-stab vests for PCSOs. I've been on the picket line with health workers. I've worked as a minister to get access to decent skill training for members in the private sector. I've worked with UNISON's members in the energy sector and the water industries. And I'll be there if they attempt to close down check-off arrangements. And I'll be with you to get the fight to get more working-class people into Parliament. And one last thing. You can't freeze wages for 5 years without public sector services being affected. It is now time that public sectors need a pay rise. I'm sorry not to be with you personally. Enjoy your conference.
A few inches on Dave. Friends, I'm sure nobody in this room needs reminding of the size of the mountain that we have to climb if we're to win in 2020. We need a strategy for UKIP, we need a strategy for the Greens, and of course for Scotland. But four of the five voters we're going to have to win back to have any chance of getting back into government voted Conservative on May the 7th. And if the Tory boundary changes go through, proportionally, there could be more constituencies in the south of England, outside London, making that task even harder. I'm the only candidate on either ballot with a record of winning and building for Labour in the kind of former safe Conservative seat which we're going to have to win in droves to get back into power. I would also be a loyal and a trusted deputy. I've always been loyal to Labour leaders, to Tony, to Gordon, and to Ed. I've been prepared to go out and fight for them at their and our toughest moments, but I've also been prepared to deliver hard truths to them in private when they've been wrong, and I do so on behalf of the wider Labour family. I don't want to be leader. I've never wanted to be leader. I don't have my own agenda. I could work with any one of the leadership contenders, and in fact, I think I complement any one of them in useful ways, whether of geography, of politics, or of gender. I also operate an open and inclusive politics. It's a politics which I think helped us treble the Labour majority in Exeter on May the 7th. It's the kind of politics which I think the British public like, and it's the kind of politics we need as a movement if we're to broaden our appeal and win that election. But if we're serious about being open and inclusive, that must also mean improving our engagement and inclusivity with trade unions and trade union members. I want to mend, not end, the trade union link. And that means we need to make the positive case for trade unions and for trade union membership. But we must not allow that relationship to be defined by what one or two trade union general secretaries say, and I don't mean you, Dave, or by what the Tory press try to report about controversies around candidate selections. Now, I joined my local NUJ branch as a journalist in Exeter before I joined the Labour Party. I've since become a member of USDAW and of the GMB. But I think because people don't generally see me as a trade union member of Parliament, I think I am well qualified to defend that link. And we all know the relationship works very well in most cases at local level. My local council leader is RMT, not affiliated, but they help us financially. I've worked very closely with UNISON colleagues and friends in the Southwest over the years on a number of campaigns, most recently in the last Parliament, the successful campaign to see off government plans for regional pay in the ambulance service, which should have just been the start to regional pay across the NHS. But one of the most scary statistics of the last election was that while the Conservatives had a 17-point lead among people working in the private sector, Labour only had a 3% lead among people working in the public sector. And Stella is absolutely right. We have to work better and more effectively with our trade union friends to grow trade union membership both in the private sector and in the new economy. That's how the Labour trade union movement will survive and thrive in the future. Finally, people like attaching labels to us all in politics, particularly political commentators and other politicians. Left, right, Blairite, Brownite. But the only labels I've ever accepted for myself have been Labour, loyal and winning. And that's why I hope you'll support me for the deputy leadership. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Our challenge over the coming 5 years is to knock our party into shape again to win, so that we can improve the lives of working people and make the world a better place. So let me start by telling you something about my work and union background. I've been in the Labour Party 36 years and a union member nearly as long. From 13, I had Saturday jobs and holiday jobs because it was expected that I should make a contribution to my costs, especially when I went to FE college and university. But my first job after graduating was working at the GLC ILEA doing transport planning. I went on to work in the groundbreaking Contract Compliance Equalities Unit, where we worked to ensure our contractors and suppliers did not discriminate and followed good employment practice. I was my unit's NAGO representative and later a workplace union rep at Lambeth Council. At Lambeth, I oversaw the recruitment and training of our first women bricklayers, electricians and plumbers in the DLO. I also established Lambeth's first workplace nursery at a time when they hardly existed. And at the GMB as their political officer, I helped run their political fund ballot. I've been an MP for 18 years, where my largest private sector employer is Polypipe. 6 out of 7 workers in the private sector are not in a union. So 15 years ago, I lobbied the largest private employer in Don Valley to recognise the union, the ISTC as it was then. When they refused, we forced a ballot, and I wrote to every employee and stood at the factory gate. We won recognition, and it became the largest branch in the union, now Community Union. I've always believed that MPs should assist negotiation and support dialogue, and that's the approach I took when the contract agreed by the former Doncaster English Democrat mayor led to strike action against Care UK. I believe our party can benefit from a deputy leader who has come from the grassroots, who has real workplace experience, who understands trade unions, who's been a working parent, and who has shown that as an MP, they will stand up for union recognition and good employment practice. As a minister, I had good relations with trade unions that covered my various briefs, especially on the smoking ban in enclosed public spaces. And also in the party, at the National Policy Forum, and I'm so glad to see Daniel, who's here today, who was elected just a few months ago. We worked very closely together in the National Policy Forum with other trade union representatives as well. More recently, I've had fantastic support and insight from the many unions in the energy sector, and I'd like to thank Matthew Lay and all the members from your energy sector who's helped me over the last 4 years. I've always made myself and my team available, and it's been beneficial both ways. Now, the political challenge. There are millions of people who voted Tory, including trade unionists and millions of ordinary workers. Not because they are Tory by nature, but because they did not trust that we could deliver on the many things we promised. Poll after poll will tell you that 70, 80% support good public services, love our NHS, want the police on the streets. But many of those people also voted for the Tory party, or for UKIP, or the SNP, both of which were more a cry to shake up the establishment. Poll after poll shows that people agreed with tackling zero-hour contracts, with the living wage, but many didn't vote for us. So what is our response? We must oppose this Tory government over the years ahead on the unfairness of their policies to undermine workers and their unions. But if the debate is about balancing the books versus increased borrowing, Tory austerity versus anti-austerity, we will lose. We'll mount protests and shout aloud, but come the next elections, the outcome will be the same or worse. John Maynard Keynes said that public spending in a recession boosted employment and restored growth. But he also said that if your economy is growing, then you run a surplus and you pay down borrowing. We don't want debt payments that cost more than we spend on education. So our answer is to champion fairness and responsibility. And as your deputy leader with you, we can reach out and in the interest of your members and potential members, we can win in 2020.
Okay, delegates, we'll move to the questions now. And I'm going to call them in batches of two. And I'm going to call the regions that didn't get to answer the questions this morning, ask the questions this morning. We might have got better if we could answer them ourselves, actually. First, so I'm going to ask the South West and then Wales.
Leslie Discombe asking a question on behalf of the South West region. In the past, the Labour leadership has failed to listen to UNISON's warnings on issues such as private finance initiative, foundation hospitals and academies. If you become deputy leader, what assurances can you give us that it will be different this time?
Sian Stockham, Cymru, Wales. If elected as deputy leader, what policy would you promote to ensure fairer funding for Wales, given that the current unfairness of the Barlett formula and the failure and manipulation of the consequential funding?
I'm going to ask Stella to answer first, then Angela, then Ben, then Caroline, and then I'll move down, we'll roll down on the next question.
Leslie, you're absolutely right. One of the challenges I think we've got is we've got hundreds of thousands of people who are potentially involved in our movement. How do we use your time and effort? How do we use your intelligence about what's going on the ground better? We have systems at the moment where people have all sorts of conversations with people, but all we record is how people vote. I want to change that. I want to have two-way traffic from the grassroots up to the leadership about what's going on, because it's not just on academies and issues around education that people are trying to sound the alarm. Many members are trying to tell us that people who were formerly Labour were voting UKIP. They were trying to tell us that the living wage, the cost of living was a real issue in their area, and we didn't have a way of capturing that information and actually using it to inform our policy making. So I want us to move to an intelligence-led model where we actually use what people are saying on the ground, not just locally, but nationally too. And there's lots of new ways of technology that we can do that, but you have to have that culture that says actually our eyes on ears on the ground are the best way of understanding what's happening in our country. Sean, in terms of your question about Wales, this is a really good question. Look, there are lots of questions right now about the way in which our democratic system has changed, but our funding and our policy and our politics hasn't kept up with it. We have to be a party informed by what people are saying on the ground. So I would want to work with our Welsh members, with our Welsh members of the Assembly there, to look at how we can make sure that actually we have the kind of politics, the kind of structures and the kind of people who are able to lead those debates on the ground, and we get fair funding for everyone, because it's a real challenge across the country right now. We just haven't kept up as institutions with where people are.
I think, Leslie, we have to be much better at listening to the experts who are at the front line on the ground telling us about what's happening. I think the party was much too slow, for example, to listen to what the conference was telling us about housing and being able to build houses again. We have a good record on refurbishing back up to good standards the social housing stock, but we didn't spot, as soon as our membership did, that there was an issue with building. So we've got to create a more democratic structure and stop the top-down command system in the party and be prepared to listen more to our own memberships, to our affiliates, as well as the policy wonks in London. You've got to get the balance right, and you've got to understand that those who are out seeing things happening day by day have more of an idea of what's going on the ground. So I'd like to see that culture shift in the party so that we could actually be more in touch and have more respect for the kind of wisdom that's coming up from below. Sharon, in Wales, I think we're going to be in a very different situation in 2020. What Osborne is doing, and I think he'll do more of it in the budget, he is actually saying that the Scots can raise more of their own taxes, the Northern Irish can raise more of their own taxes. There's going to be more powers to the Welsh Assembly, and that's good. But he's going to use that as part of an excuse to say, raise your own money from your own tax base, and we're going to stop distributing money from the richer areas of the country to the poorer areas. And we need to make a case for social solidarity rather than argue about the technicalities of the Barnett formula. It's true that Wales hasn't had its fair share, but I think we're going to be looking at a very different landscape in terms of tax base by 2020 if George Osborne and the Tories get their way.
Leslie, on PFI, I mean, I think John Prescott was absolutely right about this. I think some of the early PFIs were really disastrous, but they did get better. I mean, I wouldn't have had all the five high schools in Exeter rebuilt a brand new under the last Labour government, replacing the disgracefully dilapidated schools that we inherited from the Tories without PFI. And what the heads say to me now is that not having to manage the estate of those schools actually frees them up to do the job properly of being head teacher, but we needed to get those contracts right. But we wouldn't have got all of that massive investment under the last Labour government without that kind of funding structure because of the Treasury rules at the time. Secondly, on FTs, I mean, my FT is a fantastic hospital with a very big membership, good relationship with the unions. I don't want to do anything that will unpick that, but you're right. The FT programme under the last Labour government, I think, went too far. It wasn't careful enough. The fact that mid-staffs was allowed to go through as an FT, that probably shouldn't have happened. And on academies, I thought we actually had quite a good policy at the last general election on academies, bringing them back under proper local accountability. And don't forget, the Labour's academy programme was completely different from the government, from the Tories one. Ours was about helping failing schools improve the life chances for those children. This government is about forcing schools that are doing perfectly well into the kind of system with no local oversight and no accountability or control. Sian, on the Barnett formula, you know, I don't want to make the job of our colleagues in Scotland any harder than it already is by questioning the Barnett formula, and that's not our policy, and I think it would be a mistake to do so. It's going to be tough enough for us to rebuild in Scotland, but what we do need to do is we need to grow our economy more successfully, and we need to have a needs-based approach to public spending so that those parts of not just the UK like Wales, but also the less well-off parts of England, there's unhappiness in the regions of England about the funding formulas so that they can be addressed.
Thanks, Wendy. Well, Leslie, I think, you know, with a lot of these different schemes, the devil's in the detail. And one thing I've learnt as a minister, actually in five departments, because I was also a Home Office minister for 2 years as well, is that there's a world of difference between the policy that's developed at Whitehall and implementation on the ground. And that's where I think good communication, good input up and down is very important on this. I look, some of the private finance initiatives around health centres, and look, I have got health centres now across my constituency of Don Valley where we can do more treatment outside of hospitals because of those buildings. You know, I would hate to see that go away, but some of the early deals were not managed properly because I think partly the civil servants weren't getting the best deal they could get with public money. And I think there is a role for public-private partnerships, but they have to be worked through and they have to mean something that doesn't mean that down the road public services suffer because we're paying off the bill to those people who put the money in. I think that's been one of the problems that we're facing today, that so much is having to be paid back to those who put in and services are suffering. And on academies, look, I want good schools for kids. And when we first embarked on the academies programme, it was partly to do with the fact that in some of our most deprived areas, children from poor families where no one had gone on to further in higher education, they weren't coming out of 11 years of compulsory education with a decent set of skills. And I cannot stand up for that sort of outcome. I want to make sure that our schools across the piece, and when you saw that some schools in some poor areas were doing better than others, I have to question why my kids from my poor areas aren't getting the same quality of service. On fairer funding for Wales, look, I think part of our problem in the party is that when we delivered the Scottish Parliament, UK Labour almost said job done. What we didn't do was nurture and sustain the concept of devolution. And in that way, I think we found ourselves way behind the curve and it contributed to our problems in terms of Scotland. But what we need is a fair funding formula, I think, but also one that recognises that devolution is not an end in itself. It's actually how it provides services on the ground that make people and communities feel more empowered by it being there.
Thank you, Caroline. Okay, we'll take the next two questions. First one from East Midlands and then the Black Members question. East Midlands.
Donna Gilbert, Nottinghamshire Police Branch. In Nottinghamshire, they proposed to cut 25% of PCSO jobs from October, which is 72 jobs going. What are your views on abolishing PCCs?
Thank you. And that member's question? No? That member's question.
Sorry, I was away in a wee dream there. not that you were boring me or anything. I mean that I wasn't listening. I was working.
Can you just ask a question?
I'm getting there. Just getting there. I'm just about to, give me a second. Peter Sharma, Scottish Region National Black Members Committee. And I would like to ask those who are here to stand for deputy leadership, that having witnessed the sort of fall of the Lib Dems through the election, and also at the same time having witnessed this 4 million voters who went into UKIP, and the crushing defeat of Labour in Scotland we've witnessed, as well as the crushing defeat of Labour in Westminster, what I want to ask you is, there is a growing evidence throughout the country that the black communities in the UK are drifting away from Labour and no longer have the support of Labour. Why is that the case? And what would you do to win back the black community support to Labour? That's my question.
Thank you, Peter.
Get back to what I was doing.
Thank you. Angela, if you want to answer first.
Thank you very much. Donna, police forces all over the country, including in my own patch in Merseyside, are having huge cuts made, and PCSOs are often the first in line. What they've got to do is try and live within the means that are being granted them by this government. And my police leaders are saying that it's taking away their ability to work with other public services on prevention. And they're increasingly going to be arriving after the event to clear up crime in the best way they can, rather than doing any of the much more proactive neighbourhood policing based work that makes all of our communities feel safer. And it's really, really frustrating to know that the work that you know is effective is being taken away because we have a government that wants to take us back to 1938 levels of public service. And it's up to everyone in the public service who's got influence to try to preserve as much as possible. But I always thought that PCSOs were a great part of the police family, and I'm sorry to see any of them being cut. The issue on black support for the Labour Party, we must never be complacent about any kind of support. We are, in Labour, naturally in favour of equality. We're naturally against prejudice. We naturally fight discrimination, and we have a proud record of putting legislation to further equality onto the statute book. But we also have to try to demonstrate to our black, Asian and ethnic minority communities that we can make a difference to their lives, that we can tackle discrimination. And we know that all too often discrimination still exists in those communities. We've just got to work to connect more, to have more black and ethnic minority representation in our ranks, to reach out more and to deepen our relationships with all of those communities, or it will be natural for them to drift away.
Donna, first of all, congratulations for the campaign you're running in Nottingham, and I hope Paddy Tipping listens, and I hope we as a party keep our policy of abolishing police and crime commissioners. I mean, a complete waste of money. That money could have been far better spent on frontline policing, and I hope that's one of our policies that survives the next 5 years. Peter, on BME, look,
We lost 1 million voters to the Tories from the BME communities in this general election. It's really worrying. You're absolutely right. The Hindu vote was particularly susceptible to the Tories. What was that about? I think it's partly because we have a party have got to stop treating ethnic minorities as a monolithic block to be patronised or pigeonholed. They're as diverse as the rest of us, and certainly many of those communities are just as ambitious for themselves and their children as anyone else. I mean, probably more so in many cases because they have had to struggle. So we have to have a policy offer which is about ambition and aspiration as well. The answer, we have to be much better at nurturing those who come into contact with our party, and the trade unions have a really important role to play here in terms of encouraging that. But also, I think we need to have regional targets for candidate selection. We've done such a great job in the Labour Party on women, really well, but if you look at Parliament now and ethnic minorities, the Tories are catching up with us, and they've probably got more people who are going to go to the top on the Tory benches than we have on ours at the moment. I should also add one thing and apologise that there's no BME candidate on either leadership or deputy leadership ballot. And if it wasn't for Roshanara Ali withdrawing, which is a very principled and brave thing for her to do, three of us who are here today wouldn't have been on the ballot either. So, you know, we owe her a huge debt of thanks. But yes, regional targets for BME selections. Let's stop having these selections that are reserved for favoured sons and daughters, particularly in certain regions.
Well, Donna, I think when it comes to police community support officers, it's something we can be proud of the last Labour government did introduce, because it gave a real opportunity to make sure that within our policing community, it better reflected the communities in which they serve, because we had a lot more people, women, people from black and ethnic minority communities becoming PCSOs as a result of that, and having a career route into policing beyond that as well. Look, the most important person to people in Doncaster when it comes to policing isn't the chief constable. It's probably actually the borough commander and the units that are out on the doorsteps in Doncaster policing those communities. So I thought the police and crime commissioner idea was completely bonkers from the start. I'm glad we got to our policy to get rid of it. We do need to have a quick talk, and I'm not yet there, about what sort of accountability there should be, because I have to say, given things with child grooming, Hillsborough and everything else, we need to think about accountability of our police services. I also think we should open up the discussion about how many police forces we actually need. I used to cover the areas of organised crime, for example, at the Home Office, and asset recovery. We could better serve our communities is actually we work together rather than having Heinz 48 different varieties of what that should look like. I think that would take pressure away from frontline services, because we've been all mature and grown up about the overarching services that should help our policing in our communities. And Peter, in relation to the BME community, just to throw a few stats at you, we're only 20% ahead in London, and in the south of England, where, let's face it, we've hardly got any MPs, we were neck and neck with the Tories when it came to the votes from these communities. And that is, as Ben said, we have taken this community for granted too for long. That was the same in Scotland in some respect, in taking people's votes for granted up there. We shouldn't treat everybody the same. The views of a young IT engineer from an Asian background is very different to, for example, a first-generation pensioner in Southall about their attitudes to Labour. We have to work for their votes. We have to treat them according to what they want from us, just like we would do everybody else.
Donna, what your question speaks to is that nobody should ever think there's no difference between Labour and Tory, because it's Tory government choices that are meaning that people are having to cut PCSO frontline officers, and it was Labour who were very clear that actually there was a trade-off between frontline officers and PCCs. PCCs were out the door, and everyone on this panel is right about the fact that that was a really powerful and important comment about the kind of priorities a Labour government would have, and we should be very clear that we need to keep that focus on why it matters to have people at the front line, because it is the PCSOs who pick issues up early enough. One of the things I've been really proud of in my local community is the way we've got PCSOs working with council officers actually to start joining up some of these challenges, particularly around child exploitation, particularly around some of the gang issues that we've had to deal with in my local community. You can't do that from a backroom in a PCC office. You need to be at the front line, which is why PCSOs make such a difference. But we should be very, very clear there was a very different choice we would have made about public finances and the consequences of what you're now having to fight now. Peter, in terms of working with black and ethnic minority populations. Look, I don't think it's the role of the deputy leader to run the selections in the Labour Party. I do think it's the role of the deputy leader to ask, how do we get a lot more people involved in what we do? How do we have not just a future leaders programme, but a future members programme? And one of the things I've been very keen to do in my local community is not to wait till people join the Labour Party to get them involved. And that's particularly been in reaching out in an area with a very strong diversity. So one of the things that we've done is to scout for people. I think we have to do that at both the local and national level, because frankly our representation in local government as well is a challenge in terms of black and ethnic minority communities. In order to do that, it's not just about reaching out to people, it's what happens when you get them interested, when you work out the causes that you share in common. So I'd like to see funding to support candidates from different backgrounds as well at a local and a national level, and training and support for them to be able to get involved in what the party's doing. I think we can do that in partnership with our trade union movement, because a lot of the skills that you're teaching people in terms of community organising and representation of issues are really key in terms of representation within our political structures. So there's a really key strong effort for how we work together, say in some kind of academy process, to bring those different skills together. But that fundamental principle that it's not actually about waiting for people to come to us, it's about reaching out to them and saying, how do we get you involved? How do we learn from you? And I've done that on female gender mutilation. I've done that with young people in my community campaigning on Sharia compliant loans. I've done that with young people trying to tackle gang violence. Actually, we should be the vehicle for their hopes and dreams. That we're not right now should challenge us around a whole range of communities in Britain.
Thank you, Sarah. The next two questions then, young members and Yorkshire and Humberside.
Joe Cohen, National Young Members Forum. Whilst Labour, a lot of Labour policies in the last manifesto were very popular with young workers, turnout was a bit rubbish. What would you do to get more young people out to vote?
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Democracy and accountability are cornerstones of our movement. How well do you think that our current methods of democracy and accountability are working, and how would you ensure that party representatives at all levels remain accountable?
Joe, on young people, I think we should recognise the turnout was up, and including the turnout among young people, but you're absolutely right. I mean, one of the reasons we lost the election is that the elderly voted and young people didn't. I think we need to do another thing. So I think good local organisation really matters. In my constituency, I had a record number of young people and students working on my campaign. That's because I go to schools regularly, colleges regularly, university regularly, talk to apprentices, and we bring them into the party, we engage them. We also make what we do as a party a bit more fun. We don't have so many meetings, and we have more socials and more parties. I think our campaign on Votes at 16 is going to be really important over the next weeks and months in the context of the European Union referendum. I think if you see the level of engagement that the Scottish referendum engendered in young people, we can do the same over Europe if we get those 16 and 17-year-olds on the ballot, and I think we will do that with the help of the House of Lords. And I think we also need to be better as a party nationally in giving more respect to the views of young people, to young Labour and Labour students in the policy-making process, and in our formal structures in terms of where they have positions and where they have representation. On democracy and accountability, look, I don't think it's going to be the job of the deputy leader to try to be the general secretary, but I think this is our opportunity over the next weeks and months, both the leadership and the deputy leadership campaign, for us to listen to the views of ordinary party members and trade union members who are also Labour members about how we can democratise the party's decision-making structures. I actually don't think the job that Angela did on the policy forum was not a good one. I think the policy forum process has in many ways worked very well. It's brought people in, it's engaged people, but we clearly have to be better at a party at listening to our members, listening to the voices and what they have to contribute, and having a much more bottom-up approach to policy making rather than the top down one. And I'm sure that that is one of the lessons that we will learn from this election defeat.
Well, Joe, I joined the Labour Party at 17 at my FE college because I just happened to have a Labour club there. And actually, Liz and I have a little bit of a background working together in the youth and student movement some years ago. But look, I think part of this is, first of all, if you're not on the register, you can't vote. For a start, so we know what the Tories have done in the last Parliament is to undermine the ways in which young people get on the register, because it's all done individually. So we have to deal with the hand that's played us, so we've got to be smarter at what we do about that. I also think, you know, we did talk a lot about tuition fees, and that's important, but for an awful lot of young people, that really isn't where they are. It doesn't really something they connect with. So, you know, whether we're dealing with apprentices or young mums at a sure start, university students, or for that matter, young people who might want to start up their own business, for example, because they can't find work in any other way. I think we've just got to be open to different approaches and go with that rather than a one-size-fits-all. I don't think you should patronise young people, and I think actually having some fun in campaigns is important. And I was very pleased at Harrow the other night, someone said how much they enjoyed coming back to my place for pizza in Doncaster after they'd been on the doorstep. I think it's those sort of things that make a difference, really. On democracy and accountability, I've been around quite a long time in the Labour Party, and my God, we've had a few consultations over the years. We had the last refounding Labour. Do you remember that in the last 5 years? What happened to refounding Labour? I sometimes think our knee-jerk reaction in the party is to say we need another discussion, another commission. Maybe we should take those publications off some shelf where they're gathering dust and have a look at what we did agree and actually see if it's happening. And our party comes in all shapes and sizes. Some have an MP, some don't. Some have Labour councillors, some don't. How does our Labour family support our constituency organisation at a local level? And I think that's something we should do. But when it comes to elected representatives, councillors and MPs, I think we should be accountable. And that should be our accountability for what we're doing within our constituencies that we represent. Are we hands-on? Are we walking the walk as well as talking the talk? And are we being accountable for how we are leaders within our communities to encourage campaigning and the best presentation of what Labour should stand for, which is real community leadership?
Joe, I was a youth worker before I got elected, so I know you have to give responsibility to get responsibility. One of the things that should really challenge us in the last election, something I think, frankly, we should learn from, is in Scotland with the SNP. Because of the work they did with their young members weren't just voting for nationalism, they were encouraging their parents and their grandparents to do so, because they've become a movement. And one of the reasons I want us to become a movement again rather than a machine is to make much better use of everyone in our party. Now, with our young members, they do fantastic work campaigning. We've all been out with Young Labour, with Labour students campaigning. One of the things I'd like to bring in is a development officer so that we could actually develop the leadership qualities of our young leaders as well. So we don't just have them campaigning, but actually leading their own work, being able to go peer-to-peer and recruit their friends and family into being involved in the Labour movement, as well as running their own campaigns. And that sort of feeds on to Peter's question about accountability. Look, one of the other things I'd really like us to do is we spend a lot of money right now at national level on campaigns. But you have great campaigns, great issues, great projects that you're doing to get people involved in progressive campaigning. So I'd like to devolve some of that money down to a local level through having a match funding pot. If you've got a great idea, you want to convince people to be part of it, then we should be supporting it. Rather than spending 300 grand at a national level on consultants, let's start giving some money directly to our grassroots to campaign for the things that they know make a difference in their local communities, so that we can start showing now the difference that Labour values make, with a view to saying, imagine what we could do if we got back into government. That, for me, is real accountability. It's actually, where is the power and the money line? And that's one of the ideas I have about how we can change things.
Well, Joe, we have a fantastic, we're all Young Labour group who actually got together, brought themselves together, raised £5,000 by doing a theatrical presentation of The Ragged Trousered Philanthropist, which we all really enjoyed, and then we all went to see it and talked about politics afterwards, won a load of council seats, and really made politics fun. And if we could have We're All Young Labour everywhere in the country, then I think that we'd be much better off. I think self-organisation is really, really important, and empowering people to carry on organising. I think also, though, there's a retail model of politics, which is all about the brand, advertising, which encourages people to think that politics is a spectator sport, and then they start commentating on it, like they're sat in the stands watching the match, and then it's a choice between a blue brand and a red brand. That kind of approach to politics never leads to fundamental change in our society, and I believe we need fundamental change in our society if we're going to make our country a fairer, more equal place. And so we have to change the model of politics. We need people to understand that if you don't do politics, you get it done to you, usually by by the rich and powerful. And this is where we come on now to issues about democracy and accountability. We've got to be a different kind of party. It's no good just being a Tory party with pronouncements from the top and a load of people that get to be the background to a photo up at the bottom. We've got to create a kind of party culture where people can discuss ideas and they can go up and become party policy. I tried to do that within the limits of the National Policy Forum, and I made some progress, but it could be far better than it is. We've just got to end command and control. We've got to trust our membership more. We've got to build from the bottom up, and we've got to change the structure of how we do politics.
One from the Northwest and one from Scotland.
Peter Thorne, Northwest. I'd like to congratulate Lancashire County Council on its decision to ban the fracking applications earlier this week and last week. And I'm from Burnley in Lancashire. Would you agree that the UK government should follow the Scottish Parliament and the Welsh Assembly and ban fracking, keep fossil fuels in the ground, and work on to use the money to develop renewables?
Angela Feeney, Scottish Delegate. The general election in Scotland was dominated by a different approaches to ending austerity. Labour was at its best lukewarm about ending austerity, because of a perceived need to respond to Middle England's concerns about fiscal prudence. The SNP campaigned successfully on an explicit anti-austerity programme. How would you address the policy requirements of the different nations in the UK with a policy programme on reserved matters?
Thank you. Carol?
Yeah, thank you. So, Peter, yes. The planning process worked in terms of the applications on shale gas. But I'd have to say to you, you know, we have to take responsibility of how we're going to make sure we have the energy supply we need for the future. Something like 80% of domestic homes rely on gas central heating. So, you know, and we're a net importer of gas. So we're going to rely on gas for many, many, many years to come while still having renewables and low carbon in the system. Now, our policy was is that unless the right framework of regulations that dealt with people's concerns about the environment and so on weren't in place, fracking shouldn't go ahead. That is still our policy. We put up a number of amendments before the last election in which the Tory government found a way to shut us down on that front. So that is still our policy. But I would be less than honest with you if I wasn't able to say that if the requirements and safeguards are there, and to be honest, this is all about something that may or may not happen in every place and may not happen everywhere for 10 years, I couldn't set my face against it because it may have a part to play. But it shouldn't be polarised against renewables, and it should be done in a safe way. And in that sense, I'm glad to see the planning process working. Angela, when it comes to the SNP, you know, when I went up to Scotland in the general election campaign, I didn't see any posters on policies coming from the SNP. What I saw was big pictures of Nicola Sturgeon saying, we are the voice of Scotland. It was very much on an emotional level because it felt that Labour had lost touch with its communities, that it was taking for granted the communities in which it served. And in some way or another, devolution wasn't felt to have worked that well. People didn't feel empowered by it. And I don't think actually it is about, you know, saying we can just have, you know, sensible spending versus anti-austerity. I think the Labour Party should be the Labour Party who recognises that in times of difficulty, the broadest shoulders should bear the heaviest burden. But we should also be a party that recognises that if we aren't seen to pay down the debt in some way, that then means we sacrifice other areas in terms of public spending. So I think we have to have a policy that recognises that, that does answer the reason why we lost, not just in Scotland, but in the north, south, east and west of England, and in Wales as well, because people didn't believe we were credible on the economy.
Peter, I look at fracking in the context of that 2 degrees target, because frankly, we can have all the arguments, all the passion we have for the future. If we're not going to hit that 2 degrees target as a world, then we know our children aren't going to be able to inherit it. One of the issues for me about why we have to be sensible about fracking as a principle is that if the choice is going to be between gas that's being fracked in Poland, where it's not being managed in an environmental way, and the gas that we have here, and the difference in the way in which they do it in Poland is going to contribute to that 2 degrees target, we have some difficult conversations to make. Now, I'm pleased that the people in Lancashire were able to have their say, and Caroline is absolutely right, the planning process has worked. But if we don't talk about climate change and social justice, who will? Because frankly, it's not going to be the Greens. The Greens are not putting forward a positive story about the kind of world to come, about the kind of jobs, about the kind of sustainable development that our communities need. And we need to be able to have a conversation with people about what the different technologies offer. I don't think fracking will happen for a long time, but I do think we've got to say, look, if at some point there's a choice between what's going on in Poland and we haven't dealt with what's going on here, then we've got to look at the 2 degrees target. And I'm not going to lie to you, but that's something that's very pressing on my mind, not just when it comes to fracking, but when it comes to all of our energy choices as a country. In terms of Scotland, look, Angela, one of the things I think is really powerful about the SNP is a bit like UKIP, and frankly the Greens as well. They tell a story to people about how if your life is not how you'd like your life to be, here's a group of people you can blame for it, and here's a group of people who defend them. I think we have to go back to very first principles, which is nationalism is the enemy of solidarity. In a world that's never more interconnected, do we think we are more likely to deal with those challenges, whether it is climate change, whether it's social mobility, whether it's poverty, working on our own or being able to cooperate with other nations? And when I hear Alex Salmond in Parliament and the way he talks about the English, I know he doesn't care about the kids in my community. But I tell you this, the whole point about the Labour movement is we care about the kids in every community in this country, because we know there are young people in this country with amazing amounts of talent. They haven't necessarily had the opportunity to realise it. When they realise that talent, we all benefit. Whether it's the kid somewhere in this country who could cure cancer, imagine how that would be, or the kid who could create a fantastic new energy resource that means we'd never even have to look at fracking to begin with. We've got to be the party that stands up for the idea across this nation there is potential, and when we work together through social solidarity, we achieve it. And we've got to be able to have that conversation in Scotland with people too. And that is going to be hard, but it's got to be about our values, and it's got to be about the fact that first and foremost, a culture that says you blame the English, or you blame Westminster, or you blame immigrants, or even that you blame modern capitalism, doesn't help those young people who need us to be behind them right now. That's why I joined the Labour movement, and I suspect that's why you did too.
Climate change is the biggest threat to some of the poorest people in our world. It's even now causing huge upheavals. And we have to try to do what we can to get an agreement that people worldwide will honour. And fracking causes, helps in some of, helps us deal with some of that if it can be done safely. So I think the precautionary principle which Caroline outlined is right. I don't think it helps when the Prime Minister's father-in-law gets heard talking about fracking in areas of the desolate north. I think that doesn't exactly help us move forward together. But we have to look at the science with these things, and we have to protect our environment and think about climate change. Those are the balances we have to gain. Angela on Scotland, I went up for the referendum, and I also went up and got a lot of doors slammed in my face and worse during the general election. And there's no doubt about it that there was a tide of nationalist emotion and real visceral anger which was aimed totally unfairly in many ways at the Labour Party, and we lost a lot of very, very hard-working and good colleagues in the Labour Party up there who've had to deal with the most enormous difficulties and sometimes dangers when they're on the campaign trail. I think we fell between two stools on austerity. We sounded like we were being more austere than we actually were, but we also have to recognise that we lost the election because people didn't think we were economically credible, and they didn't trust us to look after the economy, and so they didn't want to listen to the rest of our very good offer on policies because they didn't really believe we'd look after the basics, and we have to address that. One of our problems that we didn't really address what caused the deficit in the first place, and we have to be much more aggressive, I think, in dealing with Tory myths, not to let this false narrative about the deficit carry on doing us damage. And Osborne is already doing that with his trap on the surplus, which will feature in next week's budget.
Yes, Peter, I'm afraid, like the others, I don't support a total ban on shale gas extraction. And particularly given the European context and the behaviour of President Putin, I think the more dependent we are on Russian gas, the worse really for our economy. And gas is better than oil, which is better than coal if you're talking about climate change. We have to have all of the clean technologies. But where I think the government has got this wrong is the huge tax breaks they're giving to the fracking industry while they're cutting the tax breaks for renewables, which is going to devastate onshore wind and is creating real uncertainty in the renewables industry. So I think Labour's policy on energy and Caroline's policy on energy was much better than the Tories. It still is, and we need to make sure it's better still in the run-up to the next election. Angela, on Scotland. It's funny, this thing about austerity, isn't it? Because actually, if you look at our manifestos, the SNP manifesto was more austere than ours was. They wanted to pay down the deficit more quickly and more severely in this parliament than we did, but we let them get away with it. Yes, Angela's right, because we didn't defend our record, but actually I think Caroline's also right. This was not about austerity. It was about emotion and it was about nationalism. And look, the Labour Party's problems in Scotland run very deep. I was shocked to discover that in some constituencies we had a contact rate of less than 1% at the beginning of the short campaign. Now, that is a scandal. And how those candidates and MPs were ever allowed to be so inactive, that's something that should never, ever be allowed to happen again. We've got a big job of work to do in Scotland, but we lost the election not because of austerity. We lost because the people didn't trust us on the economy and we had a massive deficit on leadership.
One from the West Midlands and one from the Greater London region. West Midlands.
Hello, Lee Bowers, West Midlands. Our question is on welfare benefits. What is your view and how will you counteract the Tories' attack?
Lynn Bentley, Greater London. If nominated by a trade union, would you accept a donation towards your campaign?
Not that we're thinking of giving any. Lynn. Okay, and we'll start with Stella.
Lee, you've picked up on one of the critical issues that next week, I mean, there are people who must be, I'm already seeing it in my local community, people are really, really frightened about what is going to happen next week when we get the emergency budget from George Osborne. And it makes no fiscal sense, because actually right now, our economy is starting to grow again, and what we need to do is make sure we keep that growth going so we can start to do the work, finally, to tackle some of the productivity challenges. The trouble for us is if we let this become a debate about welfare rather than what's working, we will lose. So we have to be very clear that George Osborne's late conversion to the living wage is suddenly something he thinks is a good idea, doesn't cut the mustard. There is absolutely no point in penalising people for getting into work, which is what cutting tax credits will do, at the expense of saying, hang on a minute, why isn't it that people are being paid a decent and fair wage? Now, I think there's a lot more that we can do around campaigning on the living wage. Like I said, look, one of the things that struck me over the last couple of years is a lot of members, a lot of activists were talking about living wage issues, really creative ways of making the case. Because after all, there's a really good economic case for it, but we weren't listening to them and looking at how we can do that. And we should be challenging this government about actually what is going to keep our economy going. Is it consumer spending falling because people are going to be struggling to keep a roof above their head? Or is it actually getting people into proper, decent paid work? Same goes for housing benefit. You know, one of the reasons why our deficit is £25 billion higher than it should be is to spending all that money on housing benefit and not building homes for people. People of this country aren't daft. They see where waste is happening. They need us to not just be in opposition to them, but be an alternative about how we would build houses, how we would tackle the private rented sector, how we would make sure that people can keep a decent wage and keep food on their tables. Look, that's why we took on the legal loan sharks and took on credit unions in this movement. But actually, we need to be much clearer about why it matters that people aren't struggling and aren't lying awake at night worrying about debt. And that's something I think we could be really powerful as a party movement, and it's particularly an issue when it comes to welfare and work. Lynn, in terms of trade union, I would be proud to, because we know that trade union money is the cleanest money in our political movement. And furthermore, a lot of what UNISON has done in the way in which it campaigns is very transparent about that funding. And frankly, I'm not going to take any lectures from George Osborne and people who took money from Adrian Beecroft, who took money from Wonga, in terms of the Tory party, about trade union funding, because I bet you they didn't consult the people who were borrowing from Wonga to be able to make that donation, because I'm certainly sure all those people that we work with who had payday loans would not be keen to seeing that money going to George Osborne's coffers. So I'd be delighted.
Well, thank you very much. Lee, first of all, I think we should stop calling it welfare and start calling it social security. This is another false propaganda narrative that the Tories have used shamelessly about how almost everyone who's on benefits, and they don't define that, is a scrounger, a shirker, not a striver. And these are words that George Osborne has used in his budget. And he only backed off that when we pointed out that 60% of the people that got low-paid in-work in benefits were actually in work. They weren't skiving. They were actually striving. They were suffering from not having enough money because their pay was too low. So we have to challenge a lot of these myths about social security and ensure that we put to bed this false narrative. That doesn't mean that we don't accept that some people are playing the system, and they should have the book thrown at them. It's very important that the system stays legitimate and that people who contribute to the system believe that it's fair, and we are not in that position at the moment. Trade union money, yes, of course I'd accept a donation from the trade union movement. It's the most regulated money, it's the most transparent money, it's the cleanest money in politics, and it's the expression of the will and the democratic decision making of millions of people up and down this country. It's not the hedge fund millionaires that now bankroll the Tory party. It's not President Putin's judo partner that went to one of their fundraisers. It's not the people that have just paid £400,000 for a photograph of the new Tory cabinet at their summer ball. I would be proud to take money from the trade union movement. Long may you be able to be involved in politics. You should do more of it.
Lee, yeah, I mean, I think the secret's in our name. We're the Labour Party. We are the party of work. And I think whether we like it or not, too many people, unfairly in my view, had the impression at the last election that we weren't on the side of people in work. We were only on the side of the victims of the Tory government. And we have to get that right next time. But we also have to defend, as Angela absolutely rightly says, the social security system. And I agree with her, stop calling it welfare. Call it what it always has been, which is social security. And let's not forget that the biggest assault on the social security system that we're likely to see in the budget next week is on people in work. It's going to be on tax credits. Those families need that top-up to their wages just to survive. So part of the answer, Stella's absolutely right, is increasing the minimum wage and growing the living wage. And I'm very proud to say that Exeter's Labour Council was one of the first local authorities in the country to introduce the living wage as a minimum mandatory across its workforce. But we do have to make sure that people see us as on the side of work, and people who can work, who are able to work, are encouraged to, not forced to, but encouraged to and helped to. And those who can't are properly supported. Lynn, I'd be very happy to take your money if you're offering me. We're actually all right in Exeter because we get help from Usdaw, we get help from the GMB, we get help from the CWU. This doesn't make me beholden to any of these organisations. But I don't just want their money. It helps, but I want their energy and their ideas and their local members to be active in my local party. I don't want this just to be a transactional relationship. I want it to be a relationship which helps us build and grow the Labour Party, bring more trade union members at grassroots level into our local parties, in positions of responsibility, standing for council, standing for parliament, because that's how we're going to win, not making it just about money.
Actually, our system in terms of welfare is broken, to be honest. I think it needs a thorough good look at, and I agree with colleagues who said about, you know, we stop using that it's a social security system. It is that safety net. It's basically, I think a couple of years ago we celebrated beverage. And the reason why I think it's broken is because actually, you know, for many, many years, and I was employment and welfare reform minister, Actually, we've overlaid things. And it's incredibly difficult for people working in job centres and elsewhere to just keep up with the number of changes that have gone on. What I would say is this, that we had some good schemes in the last Labour government, for example, Pathways to Work, which were aimed at helping people with disabilities actually get work. And we had support from the trade unions, employers to do that. I would also say that when it comes to in-work benefits, and there have always been in-work benefits in one way or another, I do think it's fair for us to have a discussion about how much we should let employers off the hook. Because I actually don't think that is fair when it comes to a point where employers aren't paying what they should pay. And in fact, all of us are subsidising all these employers. So, you know, maybe the time is to have a better discussion about a living wage and what it should mean. Because I do think it's wrong when I hear someone on the radio this morning somehow suggesting it's shop workers shouldn't actually get a decent wage because they're helping them have discounts on their food shop in that very store. I don't think that's acceptable. But that doesn't mean it's acceptable what this government is doing, because it's got a problem. Because it probably thought it would have the Liberal Democrats in with them and therefore it wouldn't have to follow through. And now they're stuck in a hard corner, and we will fight tooth and nail to make sure that what they do is minimised as much as we possibly can with the votes we've got. Lynn, I'm not against having a union donation. I'll say why, whether I get one or not, because if we start going down that route, we're accepting the Tories' framing of this whole debate, which somehow there's something dirty, something behind the scenes, something that shouldn't be talked about in relation to our relationship with you and other trade unions. We have got the cleanest system in the world, probably, when it comes to political donations, particularly the trade union law framed around this. I wish it could be as clean around some of the other areas in which donations come from, in terms of hedge funds and what have you, but we should be proud of that. But like Ben, it's got to be more than just a cash exchange. And I'm hoping that as a result of this election, with affiliated members signing up to support the Labour Party by taking part in this election, and by me as an MP having greater access to those individual members of trade unions, we can have something that can grow and develop and we can be proud of fits the 21st century, maybe more than the 20th century.
Okay, the next two questions, one from the LGBT group rep and one from the Northern region.
Hello, Chris Wills, LGBT group rep. As a trade unionist and Labour Party member, I'm extremely proud of the party's achievements towards LGBT equality over the years. In fact, LGBT Labour, which I'm also a member, is 40 years old this year. But there are obviously still a lot of achievements that need to be made. A lot of people think that now we've got equal marriage, it's done and dusted, but there's still a very long way to go. And I'd just be interested to hear what the candidates have to say about what we still need to achieve in terms of LGBT equality.
Thank you.
Jackie Godward from the Northern Region. The party was born of the trade union movement. How would you look to strengthen that link, and would you commit to repealing the Tory anti-trade union laws that were first introduced in the 80s and the 90s?
Firstly, Chris, I'm as proud as you are of the work that the last Labour government did to bring real and true equality in law to the LGBT community. Our main task now, I think, is actually to make that law a reality for the vast number of LGBT people in our country. You can have a law. We've got equal pay laws on the statute book. We've still not achieved equal pay. So we've got to go out and ensure that no one in our country who's LGBT is bullied or discriminated against as a result of their sexual orientation. And there's a lot more work to do with that. There are some other issues on trans rights. There are also issues about pension and survivor benefits, a few things like that. And the balancing of education and expectations in some religious schools is also an issue. There's an issue of bullying as well that we've got to sort out. But in general, the law is pretty good now, we just have to make it a reality. And then we have to work worldwide to protect our LGBT brothers and sisters around the world, some of whom are in jail as we speak, and others of whom are being subject to the death penalty because of their sexual orientation. Jackie, I don't think we need to repeal every Tory anti-trade union law, but we certainly need to try to strengthen and recreate collective bargaining structures in our country. We need actively to promote trade union membership and protection at work. We need to sweep away some of the technical issues that case law has put around taking strike action and strike ballots, which make it almost impossible to get action okayed. And we've got to oppose the Tories' new Trade Union Act, which will make it even harder for a trade union's voice to be heard, particularly on the thresholds for ballots, the attack on facility time, the attack also on the trade union's political voice, demanding that you opt into the political fund rather than out of it, all an attack on the trade union and labour movement, which has to be resisted.
Chris, well, in contrast to what I said about the absence of a BME candidate on either ballot, I'm delighted there are two of us from the LGBT community on this ballot. And you may know that when I was elected back in 1997, I fought the most bitter campaign against the person who was Britain's leading homophobe at the time, called Dr. Adrian Rogers, who ran something called the Conservative Family Campaign. And I think I'm right in saying I was the first Member of Parliament who'd been selected as an openly gay man and then elected. And I think Andrew's absolutely right. We can be really proud of the Labour record and not stop reminding people of that. But there are a number of challenges we still have to face. Homophobic bullying in schools is still rife. There are sectors of our economy and our national life where we're still a long way behind. Sport is one example, but there are certain professions as well. We need to do much more with those organisations to encourage people to come out and be themselves. The other thing I wanted to say is, on the international front, it's totally shameful for Chris Grayling to reverse the policy of the last few years and order British embassies to stop flying the rainbow flag on Pride days. We need to fight that in the Commons, and we need to fight that very hard indeed. And the other area which is really matters to me, because I'm also a member of Christians on the Left, is the challenge in the faith groups and organisations. We need to have the discussion with the Christian churches, but also with the other faith groups, because there are priests now who are married to their same-sex partners who are being subjected to industrial tribunals and risk losing their license to practice as priests. That's completely unacceptable. And I say that as a Christian myself, so there's still a long way to go. You're absolutely right. Jackie, I agree with Angela, and I'm going to run out of time soon, so I agree with everything she said, but I also think that the challenge in the next 5 years is not going to be what we can do when we're in government. It's going to be fighting what this government is threatening to do when we're in opposition, and we have to be really canny about this. And the other thing we have to get right is the EU referendum, because the biggest threat to trade union rights and labour laws in this country is our exit from the European Union, and we as a movement must be united in fighting for a yes vote in that referendum.
Well, Chris, I don't want to repeat what Angela and Ben have said, because I agree with them 100%. But just to pick up on something that Angela said, you know, it's one thing to pass a law, it's another thing to make sure it happens. And before I was an MP, I was chair of a national childcare charity. And as an employer, we didn't use "we are an equal opportunity employer." We said we strive to be an equal opportunity employer, because when you start thinking the job's done, that's when you get complacent about these things. But I think it is important to recognise it's about, you know, before we get into the fact that people enter the workplace and what have you, it's what goes on earlier on in childhood as well, and the bullying points that Ben and Andrew have made. But also, we're here to win elections to make the world a better place, because we are internationalists, and we should never forget that what rights we've secured here are something people actually aspire to overseas, and always be mindful of that. Jackie, when it comes to legislation, look, I think, you know, one of our biggest fights is we're going to have to fight against further legislation, for example, to reduce the right to strike. I said on Any Questions just a few weeks ago that I would oppose that. I think, again, just like our political fund ballots, we have some of the strongest and clearest and transparent rules around seeking strike action anywhere else, anywhere in the world. And to attack unions on this when we know There are far fewer days lost in strike action today than there were 20 years ago. It is not about trying to put something right, it's about trying to knock trade unions and in doing so also knock the Labour Party. But some changes I would like to see, I do think we should still campaign on removing the arbitrary charges on employment tribunals. I think that's completely unfair. I think actually there are also ways to look at what more we might do on representation. I think when somebody is employed in an organisation where they feel they're not being treated well or badly and there is no union there, I think actually the employer has to have a legal responsibility to provide that employee with a list of agreed organisations, including trade unions, that can give advice to that individual member. I think that would help us to build on our trade union representation beyond what we did in the last Labour government. I also think we need to have a look at the two-year issue around employment rights as well. Too many contracts are short-term today. We've led to zero-hour contracts, employing someone for 6 months, cutting them loose, and therefore not having obligations on that front. So I think, again, I haven't resolved what this should be, but I do think carrying on from our manifesto pledges around 0 hours, looking at something around employment rights and protection for too many workers that are on seasonal, short-term contracts is something we could look at again.
Chris, I think the battle on equality has still only just begun. I was very proud to be part of the campaign to get sex and relationship education into every school, working with young leaders across this country to make the case that, especially for young children thinking about coming out, the bullying they faced in school was one of the issues that we wanted to deal with, let alone the ideas of their teachers and some of the things that were said to them. I'd love to see sex and relationship education being made statutory, because at the moment we teach our kids about composting, but we don't teach them about consent. It has to change. I'd also like to see, I agree on transgender rights and pension rights. I think there's something also about our asylum system as well. I see a lot of LGBTI people who are facing horrible discrimination within our asylum system in the UK, and that offends me because our commitment to social justice, our commitment to equality, shouldn't stop at our borders. And yes, we should be champions of human rights abroad, but we should also do the same thing here when we treat people how they come here. Jackie, in terms of trade unions, when Matt Hancock talks about taking hit squads to trade union rights, we know we've got a fight on our hands now. And they are very clear that this is about a very sinister agenda, about curtailing people's freedom of association, freedom to criticise this government. And we're all seeing it within the public sector, and we're going to see it increasingly within public life as well. So yes, we've got to do all sorts of things to change that. We've got to stand up and challenge the gagging law, because clearly that has affected our ability to campaign as well. I think there's also something about enforcement when it comes to trade union rights. Yes, I completely agree with Caroline about tribunal fees, but there's also enforcement of the gangmasters legislation, enforcement of the minimum wage. We're just not seeing this government supporting those rights that people already have, let alone trying to repeal them. The trade union bill, look, there's already Section 54 of the Trade Union Act. If you wanted to have different ways of balloting people, that's already there. They've never talked about that. So clearly the way they're talking about taking away an increasing threshold is actually about stopping trade unions being able to be effective voices. But I also think we have to have a very positive agenda about why it makes a difference. And one of the things I'd like to see us do is learning from Germany, where you've got worker representation on boards, and it's made a real difference in people's sense about why it matters to work constructively with your workers as you're looking at the new economy to come. So let's just not talk about having to fight this government. Let's talk about an alternative agenda around trade unions and the positive contribution they make, so we can smash the myths that people like Matt Hancock are trying to put out there. Because in the next 5 years, this is going to be a really cool fight for us.
Thank you, Stella. We have run out of time for any more questions. So we now come to the closing remarks for each of the candidates. We will take them in the same order. So, Stella, I know you've just spoken, but you're on next. Thank you.
There are three reasons why I'm asking to be your next deputy leader. Firstly, because I want us to win. Now, I may not look much like John Prescott, but like him, I like nothing better than kicking Tories out of governments. Because I grew up in this country in the 1980s and 1990s. I saw the damage they did to friends' and families' lives, and I am still angry about it. And if we think this lot have been bad for the last 5 years, we all know what second-term Tory governments do to Britain. When people want to tell you there's no difference between Labour governments and Tory governments, tell them about child poverty, about a government that just wants to abolish the idea of child poverty and a government that was lifting kids out of poverty. But the thing is, those communities that are struggling now need us not to wait until 2020 to start that fight. We have to go cause by cause, community by community, showing the difference that Labour makes. We can do that. We did that when we changed George Osborne's mind on the legal loan sharks. We can do that around the living wage, around ending unpaid internships and the exploitation of our young people, around housing, around an alternative welfare system. Let's not let them off the hook for the next 5 years. Let's get cracking now. But in order to do that, we need to become a movement again, because we need voices out in every community fighting for that alternative Britain. This isn't just about new faces at the top, it's about new faces supporting us. It's not just about a new leadership team in Westminster or in Scotland, it's about the 250,000 leaders we have in our movement, about the hundreds of thousands of people in our trade union, about the millions of people who share our values but don't share our membership card. We have to have new ways of working, new technologies and new techniques to be out there working with them. And you need a deputy leader who's not going to be in a back room in Westminster, but is going to be going CLP to CLP, being a bridge between the membership and the leadership, making us a movement again, not a machine. Now, I have that passion for social justice. I have a track record of innovative and creative forms of campaigning. And above all, I have the confidence that if we work together in that way, we can and we will win in 2020. Thank you.
Tell you why I'm standing to be your deputy leader. I never ever again want to feel like I did at 1 minute past 10 on election night when that shock exit poll came in telling us that we'd lost. I knew at that moment, despite all of your hard work and dedication in UNISON Labour Link, that we'd let millions of people in our country down, and I never want us to do that again. I joined the Labour Party so that people like my mum and dad would have a better chance in life and couldn't just be written off because they were born poor. And unless we change and reform our party now, we risk letting down another generation of people like my parents. With a majority Tory government already laying waste to social justice, we are facing a huge test of our capacity to change. And we have to communicate our policies in a language people can understand. That's why, as Deputy Leader, I will change how we campaign so we're better connected to all of our communities. I will change the organisation to get rid of command and control and give members and supporters like you more of a real say. And I will never be afraid to tell our leader if they're getting it wrong. But I won't be doing it on the front page of a hostile tabloid newspaper. If you elect me, I promise that you'll always know where I stand. I'm proud to come from a working class family. My upbringing shaped my politics and gave me my fighting spirit. I'm a proud socialist and trade unionist, and I will always fight for the voice of workers to be heard louder in our party and in the country. I will never stop fighting for equality. David Cameron may have told me to calm down, dear, but I never will while the Tories are in government. I'm a straight talker, an honest broker. I will hold our party together as we rebuild. I will be the member's deputy, and I will always put you first. Thank you, Rose.
This is Tom's words again. Shall I tell you the hardest truth I've learned in 10 general elections, and in 60 by-election campaigns. The hardest truth of all is when we lose an election, it is our own fault. Not individually, of course. Individually, it's a movement of heroes. It's unbelievable what Labour people like those in this room give. But at the collective level, defeats don't just happen. It's what we've said or didn't say, what we did or didn't do that counts. And in this case, we lost touch with working class people at least 10 years ago. And so we lost. The one follows directly from the other. You lose touch, you lose elections. I'm here today because I've got the ideas, the experience, the backbone and the battle scars to help make it stop. Because let's be clear, the UKIP problem is not a UKIP problem. It's a Labour problem. Our people weren't voting for them, they were voting against us. We all met them on the doorstep, Labour for generations. They finally snapped and turned against us. Millions of them. And millions more whom support is more conditional. They didn't trust us with the economy, so they turned unbelievably to the Tories. 60-odd uninterrupted quarters of economic growth, and now we're not trusted to run the economy. How did we let that happen? In Cameron's Britain, children go to school hungry, and they leave school without hope, because we got it wrong. That's what happens when we lose touch. But we can win in 2020. We've got to win in 2020. We've got to regrow and rebuild and become the unbeatable team that we were 10 years ago. The power is in this room, in our movement, in our ideas, in our people. Those unbreakable Labour words that mean everything. Us, together, each other, united we stand. Let's take the Tories on and take our country back in 2020.
I'll be brief because you've been spoken at a lot today and we're running late. I just want to leave you with two very simple questions. Do we want to win so we can actually deliver for the people who need a Labour government? And secondly, are we prepared to take the decisions that mean we will win? Now, Harriet Harman said something very interesting, I thought, the other week when she said, we need to be thinking in this leadership and deputy leadership campaign about not who pushes our buttons or tickles our erogenous zones, but who has the ability to persuade all of those people who didn't vote for us and abandoned us to vote Labour in 2020. She was also, I think, too self-deprecating when she said if we'd done that in the last deputy leadership campaign, we might have chosen Alan Johnson rather than her. I think she's wrong about that, actually. I think she's done a fantastic job. I wish she wasn't having to be interim leader. I wish she was our deputy leader in government. But I think what she said was absolutely right. If we get the answers to those two questions right, if we get the right leadership, the right political strategy, and the right organisation, we can win. It's up to you. It's up to all of us. Let's do it.
You may feel you know me, so let me tell you who I am, why I'm Labour, and why I'm standing to be deputy leader. My mum was a lone parent at 17. I've never known my real dad. We never owned a home. When my mum married in our first flat, I shared a bedroom with my sister and my parents. Twice in my teens, I had to live away from home, the second time because of my mum's alcoholism, an illness that would kill her. By my mid-20s, I was on my own with two children under two. I know what it's not like to need a Labour government, to be on benefits, to worry about money, to need a job and childcare, and a secure roof over your head. I joined the Labour Party at 17. I never thought I would be an MP. I have never had a sense of entitlement. Over 30 years in the party as a trade unionist, I still work every day to prove myself. As a leader by example, a hands-on constituency MP, a doorstep and community campaigner, a commons performer from the dispatch box and the backbenches, a creative policymaker, and someone fighting our corner on Question Time and Newsnight, always putting the Labour Party first. That's what we need from a deputy leader. Our party is not a pressure group. We exist to win elections to make the world a better place. To do that, we need support from all classes, all backgrounds, all corners of the UK. And in the run-up to 2020, we must oppose this Tory government while locally fighting on many fronts. And we'll only succeed if we provide real community leadership, especially where we haven't got an MP. We need a deputy leader that knows the party inside out. I do. And has the empathy to reach out and connect with voters beyond our core vote. And the experience to support and speak truth to the leader without an agenda. With your support, as deputy leader, I can help us win in 2020. Thank you.
Delegates, I just want to thank the candidates and Dave on your behalf for taking the time to come to Manchester today. I know it's probably been exhausting and it will still continue to be exhausting for what, at least another couple of months, dare I say. We're renowned for doing things very quickly, I think, in the party. But so thank you very much for today, and obviously people will take away the thoughts about what you've said to them today, but I'm sure it's been helpful for delegates to listen and to be able to do that. So thank you very much for coming today. And now we're just going to have a coffee break till 4:15.